Morning. I'll start with a confession. I get very nervous up on stage. So if I fumble, please excuse me. Before I start, I have a question. How many of you are on LinkedIn? Okay. If you are an employee, if you're looking for a job and you go and interview with somebody, do you go and add the person who interviewed you on your LinkedIn? Don't answer it. Just think about it. If you interview a good candidate, do you link that person up on your LinkedIn? If you're selling services to somebody, do you go and add that person, your potential client, on LinkedIn? I'm sure you do. I used to also. And then I realized people track, my competitors track where I go, whom I linked with. And then they showed up. I would show up at a client, do a meeting, or potential client, do a meeting, add the person on LinkedIn, and 2 days later, my competition would turn up there. Has it happened to you? Any of you? Are you thinking about it? If not, you should. You're trying to hire a great candidate. You link that person on LinkedIn. Somebody else is tracking who you're interviewing. That's the first thing which I want to just set the context with. The second thing was your personal password or your office password is a combination of your name, your spouse's name, your girlfriend, boyfriend, children, their birthdays. How many of you celebrate their birthdays on social media? So if I was to get access to your system, how difficult or easy do you think it is to get access to some of that information, which was quite private 10 years ago when we were not linked? In the unlinked world, a lot of your information was not easily available, and it could not be easily misused. But now it can be. And there is the difference between information security and cybersecurity. Cybersecurity is to do with the cyber world, where much of information in the corporate life as well as in the personal life is out there in the public domain, and it will not take a dedicated person a long time to pick up a lot of information about you or your company. I'm sure you've heard of enough cases that have happened in the last few years, and I'm not going to repeat some of them. We will talk about a few examples. And like I said, because I get nervous, if you ask me questions in the middle, it'll help me settle down a little better. But coming back to cybersecurity, if you see, it's not a CIO or CISO agenda anymore. It's a boardroom agenda. CEOs are losing their jobs if they don't have the cybersecurity right. If they don't have their cybersecurity right, people are getting away with information that belongs to a company, and that results in the company either losing business or going down. So, if you look at some of these snapshots here, none of these are IT magazines. None of these are magazines that the CIOs would have on their table. These are the magazines you would typically expect the CEOs to have on the table. But increasingly, they are covering cybersecurity as a risk. And it's out there. I'm sorry, something seems to have gone wrong. So it is too tiny. I'll probably skip this. But the other thing which I wanted to talk about was, you know, some of the system. You remember, you know, Apple got hacked, and pictures of celebrities came out in the public domain. How many people would then start trusting that organization to put their pictures on the cloud? Sony, you know, their CEO had to actually go because they got hacked. When after this movie, The Interview was being released by Sony, they got hacked purportedly by a hackers belonging to a particular country. Sony, I think their market capitalization tumbled down by about, I don't know, $20 billion or something. Their CEO lost his job. There are companies that have financial damage, their share price drops, they have regulatory impact, they have reputational issue, they have customer loss. A few recent cases in India. Indian Oil got hacked. Tata Motors got hacked. And if you see, some of these are being hacked by countries, not by individuals. So if you see the evolution of threats, my apologies, this doesn't seem to be coming out quite well. Can we do something about the lights, please? In the front, if you could put the lights down. So if you see the evolution of threats, who's attacking who? It started with unsophisticated users, with kids with access to systems, hacking into certain companies to get some data for kicks. It evolved to people trying to information. But now, what we call advanced persistent threat is by countries, by stateless organizations like ISIS. And also there are a few groups which are quite well organized around the world who go after information. If they don't like something a particular country or a company is doing, they would try to bring that company out. And I think it's time for all of you to wake up to this threat. We all live in a connected world. Your calendar is your meetings are on your calendar, which is on a mobile phone, which is linked with Google. Your mobile phone could be hacked very, very easily. I'm not trying to be sensationalist here, but some of this information, as we get more and more connected, this information is more at risk. And I think as individual and as companies, we'll have to be a little bit more careful about how we are securing our information. Just think about it as an individual. You're on the way to an interview, to a high level position, and somebody just changes the alarm on your phone, and you wake up late or you walk in late for the interview. It's a very small thing, but these things have started to happen. You are going to submit a proposal. You're responding to an RFP to a government department, and your proposal arrives late at that company. These things can result in you having a loss of business. But as you see, as the world gets more and more linked, some of these things which are very basic for us, our car tells us when we need fuel. Increasingly, you don't watch the fuel gauge, your car will tell you when you need to refuel the car. You're looking at a map which tells you a particular route to avoid because there's traffic on the route or there has been an accident in front and you're supposed to either take a detour. Your train runs behind schedule. You get an intimation typically on your phone where the personal advisor on your phone would tell you that the car is running late. Some of you may not have still experienced it, but increasingly this is how we run our life. How big is the problem? If you see this here, the biggest problem obviously is in the US. But if you see this here, and pardon the India map, increasingly it's difficult to get the proper India map. India is number 4 in terms of cyber security risks that India is facing. So number 1 is the US, obviously, followed by Canada, followed by the UK, and then we are exactly at number 4, which means the number of attacks that are happening against our country, its companies, its businesses, its individuals, is quite high. Cyber threats in numbers. Again, my apologies, so I'll talk about it. You don't have to look at the slides. The number of web-based attacks is increasing at the rate of 30 to 40% every year. The number of phishing sites that are spoofing social media sites. You assume you're going to a particular social media, but it's actually a spoofed site, is increasing at more than 100% a year. Bullying. Many of us have now got teenagers who've got access to social media, which they may be accessing through mobile devices, not through a desktop or a laptop which you can scan afterwards. They carry their mobile devices in their pockets, and they could be targets of bullies, but worse, they could be targets of people who are, including people who've got some other bad motives around children. So we have to be a little bit more careful about these things. If you look at the motivation behind attacks, Nearly 50% is a cyber crime. They want to take away your money, your company's money. They want to take away your information, your company's information, and use it for their advantage. And close behind is hacktivism. They don't like what you're saying. They don't like what you're thinking. If you look at the increasing trollism that is happening on social media, just around this whole intolerance thing, you make a statement, people go after you. You know, a particular celebrity made a statement, and that particular celebrity was endorsing a brand, and that brand took a hit. And that's what we classify almost around hacktivism, followed by cyber warfare and cyber espionage. Some of us who are professionals in cyber security, we increasingly discover the placement of bugs in the offices of CEOs. There was a particular client that I was working with, and we realized their new office was coming up, and they suddenly three bugs were found in the CEO's office. And then they actually implemented a process whereby every about a month or so, they would actually scan the offices and then some areas, sensitive areas, to see if new bugs have come in. Some of this information is real. It's not James Bond. And companies which are proactively tackling such information would not share the best practices with you. If you see most attacks in 2013-14, they had both web and social engineering kind of thing. What is social engineering? Social engineering is somebody simply calling up a company and asking for the mobile number of the CEO. Just as simple as that. Or asking for the birthday of the CEO and saying, you know, we want to send up roses to that person. And that information could be misused particularly. And how are they happening? They are happening through mobile devices, through cyber protests, through advanced persistent threat. What is an advanced persistent threat? It means the threat is not going away. It's not that somebody tries to get after you one time, doesn't succeed and moves on. They have a target and they keep attacking. In advanced persistent threat, they try to, and how do you catch if you are the victim of an advanced persistent threat? Typically, if you were to see the example of Target, I'm sure everybody has heard about Target and everybody is bored to death about Target, but I'll take a minute talking about it. The janitor company, which was cleaning the head office of that company, somebody hacked into the IT system of a janitor. That janitor had access to the corporate system of Target, and this is all public domain, so I'm not giving you something which is in private domain. This actually came out in Bloomberg Businessweek. Through that, they hacked into Target system and they inserted what is called a malware. The malware sat there, replicated itself across the network, and then started sending information out. These days, the single most effective way of catching advanced persistent threat is to analyze the data going in and out of your network. Because if a malware is sitting in the IT system, the only way you can take the malware out is to actually reboot all of your IT systems. There's no virus available which would go and take out malwares at a time. So you have to analyze the traffic that is going inside your organization and going out. And which is why, and how did Target discover that they were hacked? Because credit cards of their customers started showing up on internet black sites. That's how they realized, and then they analyzed and they realized they had a humongous amount of data going outside their network. So in advanced persistent threat, people who are going to go after your companies, they're not going to give up. They will be persistent. Some of you may be under the radar and you're not being targeted, but if you're in specific industries like utility, like media, if you are activist of some sort of, you know, if you're very close to the government, if you're in the education sector, you have a higher chance of being targeted. If you're in financial services, if you're in telecom. So either you've been hacked or it's a matter of time you would be hacked, and these hackers are not hackers, let me repeat, who would do it once and get away. They would be persistent. Multinational organizations like ourselves, we get targeted all the time. If you're having information which is either financially, which could be used, which is your information, or it is information of a third party, you could be targeted. If you look at the graph at the middle, bottom middle, the number of such events is growing exponentially. How vulnerable are you? Like I said, your applications are watching you. I realized when I went on Facebook, sometimes they would start showing me, you know, a list of people with whom I can become friends. I'm sure all of you are seeing that on your mobile. And then I realized if I was adding somebody to my phone book, they would show up on my Facebook as candidates for me to link with. I Facebook is not telling you that they're looking at your, and obviously when you install Facebook on your mobile, they ask you for access to your contact book. They're taking that information, extrapolating, and telling you that you should link up with those people. I realized if I place a particular entry on my calendar of my mobile, Google sends me an email that you're getting late for your interview. Some of this information, while it may sound innocuous, this would be used against you. So your apps are watching you. Unsanctioned cloud applications. Many companies are starting to realize their employees would upload data into cloud. Either if they're going to leave the company, they would misuse the data. But more importantly, even if they're doing it innocently, who's looking into those cloud guys? Why are they giving you free cloud access? What are they doing with your data? The perimeter is dissolving. You give a laptop to your employee or a mobile device, that employee is going to take it home and use it for personal things. The persistent spear phishing is neutralizing the kind of security awareness that we do. There is an open source intelligence explosion. And the partner ecosystem is a conduit for API, just like the janitor example which happened for Target. So operating in a digital world, it does come with new challenges and threats. Let's move on. What we have seen in our experience, organizations neglect the signs. The signs of a cyber breach can be very, very subtle, with several incidents happening at the same time. I'm sure most of you have received emails with an attachment which is very innocent, which may be coming from a company or a domain that you know very, very well, but that particular email is not coming from that company. And that can be used to enter your network. And the cumulative effect on the organization can affect the sales, can affect R&D, can affect supply chain, can affect accounts payable. It could be by local competition, it could be by foreign governments, it could be a competitor sitting in another part of the world. And it's not about just digital assets. It's about a design of a autocomp part that you have invented. It's about the design of a medicine that your company is working on. It's about an experiment, it's about something innovative that you're doing around medicine. But if it's sitting on a linked IT system, it can be taken away. A few key statistics about cybersecurity. It's about financial damage. It's about Internet of Things. Internet of Things. I'm sure all of you are hearing about Internet of Things. What is Internet of Things? It's about the fact in your mobile phones, there are beacons now which tell them, if you're walking in a retailer, the retailer knows that you're walking around in that particular store. And the retailer sends you SMSs welcoming you to a particular store. Has it happened to anybody? For example, the leading hotel chain that I stay with, every time I check in, they send me a message on my mobile phone saying, welcome to this particular hotel. They're tracking you, and they are pushing stuff for you. It's happening more in the Western world, but increasingly it will come here. Internet of Things is about the smartwatch that you're wearing. Internet of Things is about the Fitbit device that you're wearing. It's about your personal information, which you're tracking, which can also be tracked by somebody else. Do you know where your IT assets are? Increasingly, we work with companies which cannot track, well, mobile devices you can't track. You can't track a laptop or an iPad where it is going. But do you know where your servers are sitting at any time? Do you know what licenses that you've bought? What are they doing? Software licenses. Do you know where the information is sitting? If you don't have, and most companies, if they're not having an inventory of their IT assets, how are they going to safeguard it? And then when we hear from our respondents, more than 50% of our respondents are worried about data leakage. This data comes out from a survey that we did recently, and copies of the survey are actually available in our stall outside. You can pick it up. My apologies again for the quality of the presentation we are having here. But it's about all of these things. It's about data. It's about resilience. It's about Internet of Things. It's about cybercrime. Understanding today's challenges for cybersecurity, we have to understand how the attacks, today's attacks, are affecting you. How are the attacks unfolding? And why are we still vulnerable? It's not just about having the antivirus on. And lastly, I'll just pause here after this. What do you need to do? You need to anticipate the risks for your organization. You need to adapt to the new reality. And you need to activate controls. I'll just pause here and take questions. In that case, thank you for being a great audience, and I look forward to interacting with you.